This is A New Angle, a show about cool people doing awesome things in and around Montana. I'm your host, Justin Angle. This show is supported by First Security Bank, Blackfoot Communications, and the University of Montana College of Business. Hey folks, welcome back, and thanks for tuning in. Today I am speaking with Will Cockrell, the author of Everest Incorporated, The Renegades and Rogues Who Built an Industry at the Top of the World. This new book is a fascinating history of the guiding industry on the world's highest peak.
But now we have a new generation of climbers, Nepali climbers, Sherpa climbers largely, who are going out and doing first ascents. Their passion for climbing is pretty familiar.
Will has written for Men's Journal, Outside Magazine, GQ, and many other prominent outlets. Everest Incorporated is his first book. Will, thanks for joining me today.
Yeah. Hey, Justin. Thank you so much for having me.
So tell us, where did you grow up and what did your parents do?
I grew up in the Bay Area in a place called Marin County, which is just north on the Golden Gate Bridge, just north of San Francisco. My mom was a therapist, actually, like a marriage and family therapist.
Super.
My stepfather, who I largely grew up with up in Marin, owned a bookstore, funny enough.
Okay.
So since the 80s, he owned it for 40 years, only retired recently, actually.
Give us a little summary of how you made your way into journalism and writing in general.
I did political science in college, and that was more just to hold my interest to get through the 40 years because I just wasn't super excited to be there. And I was really getting into climbing and outdoorsy stuff myself around then. Sure. And I was going full on, like, with the sort of, you know, living in my truck and trying to do as much as possible. And then I would apprentice, like, for various, like, independent guiding companies. I wanted to be a mountain guide, but it was a tough life. The living in your truck thing and the commitment, the sort of graduate school level of training, you know, to get your certifications, just the cost, emotionally, physically, and literally felt like a pretty long road to travel.
Mm-hmm.
And I also just really loved writing, kind of a holdover from my political science major, which is pretty writing intensive. What I did is I sort of contemplated the idea of journalism, but of course, lean into the outdoorsy thing.
And so you do a lot of adventure writing, and this new book, Everest Incorporated, focuses on the industry around Mount Everest and the history of that. And so John Krakauer is somewhat infamous here in Missoula. He wrote a book titled Missoula, and folks around here get a little frustrated that maybe folks outside of Missoula, all they know about our town is what they read in the book. Similar effect exists around Mount Everest. Into Thin Air might be people's primary reference point on the attitudes they've formed or the information they think they know about Mount Everest. Set the stage there. How do you view your book in relationship to Into Thin Air?
I feel like John Krakauer's book, Into Thin Air, which was about a climb in 1996, a guided climb on Mount Everest, but it came out in 1997. It really did set the tone. What very few people know is that the industry was only 4 years old at that point. It was very young.
Right.
And then boom, Into Thin Air comes out. This terrible event happens in 1996 in this young industry. It was hard not to jump on board with Krakauer's take on the whole thing.
So let's maybe focus on some of those misconceptions. And, you know, a listener might be thinking, okay, do we really need another book about Everest? But, you know, I've read a lot of them and your book covers so much new ground that I hadn't considered. So talk about why you thought there was a need for another book about Mount Everest.
If we're speaking about Krakauer specifically, I mean, for starters, he's a fantastic journalist, fantastic writer, and maybe not known to everybody. He's actually a pretty amazing climber even.
Right.
In a lot of ways, he was like the perfect writer to go to Everest and do this. And so I have a lot of respect for his work. He's super talented. But I kind of see two issues with Into Thin Air. And one of them is the fact that, you know, Krakauer comes from a very like righteous background within the climbing world, this idea that climbing is all about being self-sufficient, which I completely agree with. You know, if you want to be a lifelong climber, if you want to become a climber, it is your responsibility to become self-sufficient. He went to Everest with already that, you know, with already that bias for starters. And I think that one thing that was strange was that he reported on the industry in such a way that it was like, this industry has been going on and existed for years and years and years, and something like this was bound to happen.
Mm.
So readers of Into Thin Air, I think they take away, even if he didn't say it explicitly, they have this idea that the Everest industry, the disaster that was waiting to happen, which obviously, as we know, since it was only 4 years old,
right,
you know, and nothing like that happened again, nothing like it has ever happened again, that was pretty wrong. And then there's a second piece to it, which is, again, goes back to that, his idea of who a climber is. I would be willing to go out on a limb and say that the subtext of Krakauer's book is who belongs and doesn't belong on the mountain. And I think that anyone who reads my book, you'll get into Everest Inc. and you'll start to see that I think that's probably one of the most flawed questions when it comes to Everest.
There's so many dimensions to the question of who, even the question of who should be on Mount Everest is sort of a flawed framing or a problematic framing in some ways. How did you even get your head around navigating that space?
That might come purely from my own sensibilities in our world, right? I try my hardest not to judge whether someone's doing something the right way or the wrong way, unless they're hurting someone else. Or in some cases, I think it's fair to say, or causing harm to the environment. I think that that's an okay line to draw as well. But as we know, you know, I mean, you know, Everest is going through the same growing pains as, like, you know, the Grand Canyon and some other really heavily trafficked places. I had met and known so many people within the Everest industry who I liked and respected and were even impressed by in a lot of ways, that I just said to myself, it can't be this simple. There's no way some people belong and some people don't. And all these guides are greedy and, you know, exploiting the Sherpas, et cetera. So that's what really, like, set me off on the journey.
Yeah. And that sensibility comes forth really well in the opening vignette. You recount a story of an interaction between Uli Steck and Simone Moreau, like two super prominent alpinists who get in a conflict with a crew of Sherpa who are out doing the work of setting the fixed lines and basically setting up the infrastructure for the industry, and how you approach a story like that without sort of picking sides or introducing judgment is a sensibility that persists throughout the book.
That was really important. There were so many rumors about that event, right? That conflict between the Sherpas and the Western climbers. And it was such a collision between the guiding industry and sort of everyone else. I had heard, you know, I seen with my own eyes on video, I'd seen Sherpas hitting, right? Hitting Uli, hitting some, kicking Simone. So I know there was violence. And it was literally finding and talking to the gentleman that that admitted that he hit, you know, that he hit Simone. That Sherpa is, you know, is right-hand man to one of the more well-known, well-respected Everest guides today.
Wow. Yeah.
Owner of a company called Mountain Professionals. And I had a beer with him in Kathmandu. Humanizing someone in those places, that goes a long way. It's kind of amazing.
And that humanizing piece, I mean, for the Western audience, like folks like Simone and Uli Stecker, you know, for climbers, they're household names, yet, you know, Sherpa are sort of othered in a way, and that reflects a whole host of cultural dispositions and biases, et cetera. So actually the telling the story from the perspective of all the actors in it adds a level of transparency that I don't think many outsiders typically get.
The more people I began to speak with about the industry, the more interviews I did, the more I dove in, obviously the more I knew who I could trust and who I couldn't, who was a reliable sort of witness. And the majority were, And the stories they told me as a journalist, I can spot, you know, whether they're trying to make themselves look good, you know, et cetera. And I really felt like people were ready to talk about it in a way that wasn't defensive.
Yeah. Yeah.
And so the minute that a lot of these Westerners and some of the Sherpas, although the Sherpas have plenty of reason to be defensive, began to not be defensive and began to actually unpack some of the things that they screwed up early on. Right. That was one of the most interesting things, was having them walk me through how we got to the dysfunction. Now, hearing them walk me through to the dysfunction that everyone knows about Everest just completely spun it around, or, you know, turned it on its head. It automatically, you know, this is what chipped away at this idea of the greedy guide that will just take anyone and do anything to get someone to the top. It actually turned this around, and I realized how obsessed these guides were with becoming the most successful Everest guide, or getting inexperienced people or less experienced people who would not normally have the opportunity. It's the guide's dream, right? To get them to the top of mountains and watch them go through that experience. And in a funny way, like climbing Everest itself, these guides, even if I was just reading between the lines and talking to them about their lives at that time, they were obsessed with achieving that.
Yeah, we've had Mark Sinnott on the show before, and you know, he published a book about his experience on Everest looking for Sandy Irvin's camera, et cetera. You're probably familiar with his work.
Yeah.
And he was one of those climbers, maybe in the Krakauer tradition of, you know, very much, and he wanted to do his alpinism and alpine style, and had certain sort of preconceptions about what Everest was all about. And he came back both humbled and amazed by the culture around the mountain and the people on it, and his sense of the stereotype of the, you know, rich, entitled client and the guide who's put in this sort of ethically precarious position of being paid to escort somebody to the summit. You know, that sort of stereotype fell away through Mark's experience over there. Talk about that stereotype and how you reckon with it in the book, but how did your personal sort of experience with investigating that stereotype proceed?
I agreed with, I think, the mass, you know, the masses on this, that it was fraught with conflicts of interest, right? People are paying such big money to go. And then these guides are making these decisions about whether they can go, when they can go, what day they can summit, whether let's shut down the summit attempt because of the weather. My understanding, I don't have proof of this because no one would show me their books, but Everest is a loss leader for most guiding companies.
Really? Okay.
Yeah. That's my understanding. I would say that companies like Garrett Madison's, Madison Mountaineering, and Mike Hamill's climbing the seven summits, it's possible that they are actually getting into profitable because they're just running such great, you know, operations. But for the most part, it's a loss leader. And then, of course, you talk to the guides about that conflict of interest, and they would talk me through their decision-making process and when they would have to say no to a client, all these things. And then I, as a journalist, it was really important for me to go corroborate these stories.
Sure.
And that was a big part of this too, was finding those second and third sources to say, hey, is that true? And in most cases, everybody was telling me what really happened. Again, I think it goes back to this feeling that people were ready to talk about Everest in a way that wasn't offensive.
We'll be back to my conversation with Will Cockrell after this short break. A New Angle is supported by First Security Bank, Blackfoot Communications, and UM's College of Business. Access to capital, broadband, and education are three ingredients any community needs for success.
This is Jeff Meese, media technician at the College of Business, and you're listening to A New Angle.
Welcome back to A New Angle. I'm speaking with Will Cockrell about his captivating new book, Everest Incorporated. You know, there's a colonial history. There's sort of a history of Westerners trying to, you know, explore and conquest and all of those through lines. But Everest, in many people's minds, has been an extractive endeavor. White people going to Nepal and extracting a natural resource in a way from that, you know, sovereign nation. yet you get into the nuance of how the industry is not only shifted as far as who actually owns a lot of the companies, but the economic development and opportunity that the industry has provided for the Nepalese. Talk a little bit about that, how that stereotype broke down as well.
Yeah, I'd say the colonial piece was probably the hardest to grapple with, yeah. Right? Because that was the one where it was hard to deny the dysfunction in that area.
For sure.
It was really hard to deny what had happened to Sherpas even before the guiding industry, and how some of their deaths and, you know, issues were treated. And they were doing so much. They were so indispensable and yet not recognized. That piece was really hard. So what I did is I got on the phone with a ton of the old Sherpas who had been with companies for 30 years, as well as some of the younger ones. And, you know, I sat down and talked to them, like kind of tried in a bubble in a way, right? To say, to grasp their enthusiasm. Do they feel like they've still got a foot on their neck? Like when it comes to being paid the same, I asked what some of them were being paid, and their different opportunities, finding out how much money some of them made. And then I went to Nepal, you know, it was my second time in that country. And that was the next piece, was trek to base camp. It was an incredible 10 days. I mean, it was just beautiful. And it's hard not to be proud of the Sherpas. They're so industrious, and the Khumbu Valley is so prosperous. And all these kids are going to Kathmandu and becoming pilots and engineers because of the Everest industry. And then they're coming back to the Khumbu Valley. And then you talk to the guides and you see the enthusiasm. A lot of the cynicism around Everest has to do with the fact that it's all about money. Number one, the Westerners are making money. More importantly, that the Nepalese are desperate.
Okay.
They're so desperate that they're willing to risk their lives. And that is one of the dysfunctions that existed for many years. That's totally true. But now we have a new generation of climbers, Nepali climbers, Sherpa climbers largely, who are going out and doing first ascents. Their passion for climbing is pretty familiar. Yeah. If you're a climber.
Yeah. You know, and as that new generation emerges, I mean, coming out of an era where, you know, the guiding profession and sort of how guides work is largely a Western construction, does the Nepali guiding philosophy differ in important ways?
Most of these guides don't ever plan on leaving Nepal. They feel like they've got plenty of work in their backyard, and they do, and they do. What's interesting, though, is there are a lot of Sherpa climbers who have grown close to the Western companies and become guides on other peaks around the world. So, you know, that's another uplifting thing to see, in my opinion.
You know, and that was another thread that actually touches Montana. I mean, you interviewed Conrad Anker, and he and his wife have established a climbing school in the Khumbu to educate a lot of these guides and prospective guides in the standards of the discipline. Talk about that conversation with Conrad and what you learned from it.
For starters, yeah, the Khumbu Climbing Center, the KCC in Fortse, which is one of the villages along that Khumbu Valley. It's where this gentleman, Funuru, is where he's from. Mm-hmm. And it's the full deal. It's this amazing building with like full resources for training. So ice climbing, rock climbing, the whole deal, the medical rescue stuff. And Conrad and Jenny Low Anchor, you know, they've been very devoted to the Nepali people, to Nepal for so long. I mean, he feels very enmeshed with that culture.
Yes.
And that's amazing, right? But the counterpoint, and what was so fascinating talking to him, is that Conrad never wanted to be a guide.
Mm.
You know, well, I mean, he said he has guided here and there, you know, off and on, but for the most part, he wanted to be a different kind of climber. And he unpacked why he did not want to be a guide. And it's kind of a surprising, you know, maybe I'll leave that out there, but it's kind of a surprising reason that he didn't want to guide.
Mm.
But there's this other piece too, a group of people actually that are sort of in his corner, that they walk a fine line. They don't seem, in my opinion, they don't seem to condone the guiding industry, but they also don't necessarily condemn it.
In our remaining time, I'd love to just get your thoughts on the issue of climate change. I mean, there has to be affecting the mountain and the industry in some ways. You know, it's not a topic that's prominent in Everest Inc., but how do you view climate change? And is it a threat to the industry? Is it something that could expand the climbing season? How do you think about that?
Basically, the warming was said to be causing more melting in the ice fall. More melting in the ice fall means more seracs and things dropping onto people and killing them just, you know, sort of out of nowhere. There were years that were dry, really dry years when there just wasn't much snowfall. Certainly can be chalked up to climate change, because in some years it was so dry they'd never seen the mountain so bare. The wind had already scoured it. A lot of rocks exposed. The ice was just a sort of a different makeup, to the point that guides had to huddle and say, hey, what do we do? You know, like contemplating whether they even go on with the season, because the conditions were just not what they expected. A lot of rock fall, a lot of rock melting out of the snow and come, you know, zipping down. And that would be a good example. But it seemed to me that a year would go by and all of a sudden it would have the most snowfall they had in two decades. And so all of a sudden they're dealing with an opposite problem.
Right. Whole different set of conditions.
A whole different set of conditions. And as I said, I think, you know, again, I'm not an expert, but I think you can also chalk that up to climate change, right? Mm-hmm. The extremes. But it's not as simple as like, oh, the Khumbu Glacier gets 6 feet shorter every year. And by the year 29, it'll be 200 feet long or something. It's definitely receding, but it's not like there's a tangible thing happening where climbing Everest is going to end because of a climate pattern.
Right, right. And in some ways, like maybe it'll make it less accessible in certain years and more accessible in others, and widen or narrow the weather window, and all sorts of things that we've yet to sort of see unfold.
You know, last season surprised us. I'm always curious how many people took notice, but, you know, last season was the deadliest season ever in history on Everest.
Yeah.
More people were killed climbing the mountain. I think it was 17, than ever. And so it's so interesting to be talking about the uplifting stories and the sort of direction that it looks like the industry's headed with that having happened. But ultimately, that is what's so interesting about Everest, is that people want patterns. They want patterns really badly, you know, to show that it's a mess or it's dysfunctional or to defend it. And we could easily have one or zero deaths this season.
Yeah,
that's what's wild about the mountain.
And maybe that's one of the reasons why it holds such a firm grip on our psyche, our collective psyche. You know, it's obviously the highest peak in the world, but you know, these stories and the uncertainty around it captivate us in some way.
Yeah, that's right.
So looking forward, Will, what do you think are the biggest challenges facing the industry?
I think it's the growing pains that the Nepali companies are going through right now.
Yeah.
There's so much criticism around them, and you know, ironically, it sounds very similar to the criticism the Westerners were getting in the 90s, when they hadn't figured things out yet. The Nepalis are going through a lot of the same, like similar reckoning with bad decisions and, you know, business decisions and sort of running their expeditions. And there's some egregious things happening on the mountain right now, largely within the Nepali companies. But there just always seems to be a dialogue about it.
Yeah.
There seems to be a constant discussion about, well, how do we fix that? How do we stop that? You know, there's new regulations every year, right? But in a country like Nepal, it's not exactly easy to just implement new rules and have everything sort of switch on a dime and enforce them the way it is in the West. And so I think it's the growing pains. I think it's going to be hard to watch some of these companies and some of the criticism rightfully they're going to get. There's going to be some companies that are just going to shut down. But there are a handful that run such awesome expeditions and are so suited to just take over as, you know, king of the mountain, so to speak, for the legacy companies that they're not going to go away.
Right.
So that, you know, that's heartening.
Yeah. And it's so easy for, you know, outsiders to form opinions, cast aspersions or whatever. I mean, here in the United States, we've got plenty of industries that are, you know, experiencing growing pains is maybe a charitable way of putting it, but like going through these patterns of total dysfunction and need for regulation and, you know, grappling with the ethics of their business model and all that. So to sort of position ourselves on some sort of morally superior plane, it's just sort of an odd, it's an odd conceit. And you wonder, does it reflect some, you know, colonial mindset? Does it reflect some inherent racism? I don't know what, but certainly Everest is a place that just sort of tends to cultivate judgment for some strange reason.
You know, I will say too, circling back to Conrad, he put it best to me. He explained, he was able to communicate how important Everest was to the Nepalis, how proud they were of their legacy with that mountain, and how mountaineering is their greatness.
Yeah.
That they have statues of, you know, the first woman who climbed it, that, you know, in Kathmandu. It's like, it is their greatness. He made the point. It's not like they have a cricket team that plays against Pakistan or whatever. And all you have to do is talk to a Nepali or a Sherpa specifically, even whether it's in this country or over there. And the pride is, it's a big thing.
Yeah.
And it's cool to hear. It's great to see.
So, Will, congrats on the book. I'm grateful you would share some of your busy time with us. The book is Everest Incorporated, The Renegades and Rogues Who Built an Industry at the Top of the World. I guess as we close, any thoughts about what's next, or is it too early? I know this is your first book, so it might be a dangerous question to ask you what's next.
Yeah, there's probably few places as inhospitable as that zone between first book and second book.
Yes, yes.
It's hard, right? But anyway, I'm enjoying this little ride right now because the book's not out yet. So I get to have that. I get to ride the wave of anticipation. I get to do interviews. I get to talk about this thing that I lived with for many years. And so I'm stoked.
Excellent. Well, congrats. I think it's an excellent book. I encourage anybody interested in Everest to pick it up because you will learn new things and it will change your mind about things you thought you knew. So, Will, thanks for joining us today.
Hey, thanks for your time, Justin. I really appreciate it.
Thanks for listening to A New Angle. We really appreciate it. And we're coming to you from Studio 49. Generous gift from UM alums Michelle and Warren Hansen. A New Angle is presented by First Security Bank, Blackfoot Communications, and the University of Montana College of Business, with additional support from Consolidated Electrical Distributors, Drum Coffee, and Montana Public Radio. Keely Larson is our producer. Maddie Jordan is our production assistant. VTO Jeff Ament and John Wicks made our music. And Jeff Meese is our master of all things sound. Thanks a lot, and see you next time.